back page, and that's Rose, and we have the math and dance.
I can't hear you.
The math and dance.
We chose dance because you've both been dancing for a really long time. I think it's been like a total of 22 years between the two of us. I have been dancing since I was 4, and Rose has been dancing since she was 9. This is her second year in dance because her first year picture is a little bit embarrassing.
We're not showing that to the class.
Oh. All right. So jazz dance originally goes back to the Harlem Renaissance. It was a time of freedom for black people and women all throughout the Roaring Twenties. It was a way to for people to express themselves and have energy and fun. And then here's a video of a jazz dance from about the Harlem Renaissance era. As you can see, when it starts, there's a lot of complicated footwork in the dance and a lot of energy behind it.
Now modern jazz, it's like really similar, but it just like adds more balletic skills, and it's more theatrical and challenging. And this is a more modern jazz. You can see it's still got the complicated footwork.
One famous choreographer goes by the name of Katherine Dunham. She choreographed a lot for Broadway in the 40s and 50s, and she had very worldly inspired choreography. One style she kind of intertwined in with her jazz style was what she saw natives doing in the Caribbean, and that led to her adding other nationality style dances into her dancing. And then she also opened a school in New York City called the Katherine Dunham School of Dance for aspiring Broadway dancers.
And then another prominent choreographer is Bob Fosse, and he has a more burlesque style, and he has 8 Tony Awards. He also choreographed the Single Ladies Dance, which I'm sure you guys are all familiar with, so we're gonna show that video. And then for our first problem, we're gonna analyze a sea jump and how to improve it, and we're gonna find the force, work, and power behind a good sea jump. So some problems with sea jumps are the lack of arch in your back and a small plie, which will result in having less power behind the jump. And then here is a bad one. There we go. As you can see, my back didn't arch very much, so it was just like my knees bending, and that's not good. To improve it, you can increase power by increasing your plie and stretch your back to create this arch in your back instead of just having a straight back and looking like a parenthesis. Okay, so the background on power is the rate at which work changes, and 1 joule equals 1 watt. And Benjamin Franklin is credited with discovering power in electricity. And here's the math. We took my mass and the acceleration, which we got from, I think it was this one, to find the force, which we found to be negative 439.253. And it's negative because I was applying power in the, or force in the negative direction. And then we found the work by multiplying the force by the distance and got 40.086 joules, and the power we found to be negative 74.234 watts.
All right, so as some people know, I am a fan of kicking, which is why I chose to do my dance move on fan kick. So what I did is I did a good fan kick and a bad one, and I graphed the good one on a 3D plane to determine kind of how I can improve it and whatnot. All right, so the reason the kick you're about to see is bad is because instead of staying on the same Z plane or the same coordinate along the Z axis, it's considered a D kick where it goes out and straight and then pans around. But you want a fan kick to hit 3 crucial points, which is the corner in front of your body, straight up, and then straight up on the other side, and back down. So here's a video of a bad one where you can see my leg coming straight towards you. And then around. Alright, so your fan kick is not going to be as high also if you're doing a D kick instead. So what I decided to do to improve it was I needed to stretch out my hips more to increase flexibility so I could rotate my leg around the point where my leg meets my body. And then here's a video of a better one, and it's a lot higher as you can see. And it fans around a little bit more in there too. All right, so then what I did, I used our handy dandy tracker app and I put that video on there and I graphed points along my foot to get a position, velocity, and acceleration function, but we didn't really need the velocity and acceleration for this problem. So I took the position function and I graphed it into a 3D graph. And as you can see, it is concave down for the most part, which is what I expected. I mean, some of it's kind of a little janky because plotting points wouldn't have been exact for all of them. But as you can see, along the Z plane, even though the Z variable is a constant, so we don't know exactly where the graph falls, no matter where the constant is, it stays along the same Z plane the entire time.
showing that I did a good job keeping my leg flat and not coming towards the viewer. All right, and then Descartes is the one who actually kind of started graphing. He liked to go by Cartesius for the last version of his name. What he did, he had writings from 1637 showing kind of graphing on a set of axes. A man actually by the name of Pierre de Fermat originally wrote about the concept, but he didn't publish his discovery, and Descartes was the one who found it, and he published it and ended up getting most of the credit for it. But the idea of graphing has actually been around since the 14th century. Descartes just added the set of axes. And then ever since dance teams have began and evolved from Broadway to what we do, math has been used in a lot of ways, especially to determine formations and where each girl goes. Some formations are just kind of shapes changing, but a lot of times it's also how dancers can, you know, move and bend and contort themselves into different shapes as well.
And here is an example of a formation that is uses geometric shapes. It's like two triangles with the points connected over an hourglass shape. Then our final problem we did is we found the speed that a dancer would need to have to get from here on the floor to here, which we found to be about 8.5 meters. And we also found in this video that we'll show you later that they have about 3 seconds to make that transition. So their speed has to be 2.845 meters per second. And we also found that the average step or the average stride of a person is 0.76, so about 3/4 of a meter. And the steps required to take in this case, in the 8 steps, it has to be 1.067. And we'll show you where that is in the video. Formation that took some planning. It's an M and a J because the song was Bad by Michael Jackson. So our coaches had to figure out.
I never even realized that I've seen them dance so many times.
And the coaches had to figure out how to make it symmetrical and how many dancers needed to be in each spot to make it look actually like it was supposed to.
Definitely took a lot of work.
Very cool. And then the history of velocity, acceleration, and position. They're all parts of kinematics, which is a branch of classical mathematics, which describes the movement of points. And velocity is the derivative of position, and acceleration is the derivative of velocity. Position is location of a point, and velocity is the rate at which the position changes, and the acceleration is the rate at which the velocity changes.
Okay, so now we have some experiments we could also use these mathematics to find. So if you really wanted to find the speed, velocity, and acceleration of a car, you could. Or I know there's this thing now called 3D printing, which incorporates 3D graphing. You could find the power needed to rollerblade by pushing on the ground and stuff. Or arranging people for marching band blocks and formations. All right.
That's it. All right, thank you.